Good morning, and thank you for joining in our service this morning. Our call to worship is from Psalm 139. To the choir master, a Psalm of David. O Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path, my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when you, as yet, there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake, and I am still with you.
In his hands, who has numbered every grain of sand. Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold, our God seated on his on his throne. Come, let us adore. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, hope for sinners slain. Thank you,
Our scripture reading for this morning is found in Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 11. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up. And a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. By way of announcements, this Wednesday we have a ladies' prayer meeting at 10 o'clock here at the chapel. And then in the evening on Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we have Bible study here at the chapel as well, where we're looking at the life and ministry of the Messiah. So do come out and join us for that. Also looking looking a little bit further ahead, February 6th, we have our annual general meeting. Not quite sure what that's going to look like, whether we'll be in person or how that will look, but you can already be praying in advance for that, that God would give us wisdom as we make the decisions for the chapel. And if you belong to the chapel, we ask that you would attend that, and more information will be coming to you closer to the day as to what that will look like. Also this week, on the 21st, Tavis' birthday is this week, so we pray that you have a good day and a good coming year. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, you are our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer. You are our shield and the horn of our salvation, our stronghold. When we are anxious or fearful or lonely, we are reminded that you are God and there is none else. We come to you this day in worship. God, you have called us to walk as children of the light, not taking part in the unfruitful works of darkness, and instead exposing them. But we often ignore the pain of others and turn our faces from injustice. Forgive us, God, and give us the courage to do what is right and pleasing to you. We know that your steadfast love endures forever, and that you offer us forgiveness from all our sins and shortcomings in Christ Jesus, for which we are truly grateful. God, we thank you that you hear our prayers. There are many who are currently facing different challenges with the pandemic. We thank you that you are not so far from us and that you give us wisdom and peace when we call upon you. As our call to worship has stated, you are the creator and giver of life. You formed our inward parts. You knit us together in the wombs of our mothers. We praise you, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. On this Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, we mourn the loss of the many children whose lives have been taken through abortion. We grieve with the mothers who have made this decision and have lost children through this act. We pray that you would give us love for those walking in darkness. We pray for those facing war in their countries, for those displaced by violence, for those facing economic uncertainty, that you would provide peace and assurance. We pray for those facing discrimination because of their age or gender or ethnicity, for those who are struggling with disability, and for those who are experiencing grief and anxiety, that you would bring healing and reconciliation. We are reminded today and every day that all of creation is groaning for the redemption that you alone provide through your Son, Jesus Christ. As we come to your word this morning, we ask that you would illuminate your scriptures to us, that I might speak with clarity, and that your word might make us more and more like Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
I will ever
If you have a Bible, I invite you to turn to the book of Acts, where we'll be looking at Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 11, which we've already read, but that's what we're going to be looking at for our time together this morning. Last week, we started a sermon series on the book of Acts. I've titled this series, Acts of the Risen Lord Jesus, because we aren't just looking at the Acts of Paul, we're not just looking at the Acts of Peter, or really even the Acts of the Apostles, as significant as those individuals are throughout the book of Acts. What we're seeing throughout this book is we're seeing the Acts of the risen Lord Jesus through the witness of his people, right? So through the witness of Peter and Paul and individuals like Stephen and Philip and James and all the other individuals whom our Lord has chosen through his people, through his witnesses, and the power of the Holy Spirit for the accomplishment of God's saving purposes for the world. That's what the theme is for the book of Acts. And what we're going to see for our time together this morning in our text is what it looks like to be Jesus' witness in the world. We are going to look at what it is that the risen Lord Jesus has commissioned his followers to do until he returns. Suppose Jesus came down to us today and invited each one of us to ask him a question. What question would you ask him? Would you ask him why certain things happen in the world? Would you ask him what God's plan is for your life? Would you ask him about clarification on something in Scripture that is unclear to you? What one question would you ask Jesus if you had the opportunity? Well, in this passage, we have the last recorded question of the disciples to Jesus. The disciples, they had studied under Jesus' teaching for 3 years. So certainly during that time, they would have asked Jesus all kinds of questions. And we even see that throughout the Gospels. But just before Jesus' ascension, they had time to ask Jesus one more question. And in verse 6, it says that when they came together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" Disciples asked Jesus if this was the time when Israel would be restored. Like all Jews down through the centuries, they looked forward to the day when the Messiah would come to reestablish literal, physical, national Israel. Just like in the Old Testament, in all of its glory. That's what they were looking forward to. And we see this throughout many of the prophets in the Old Testament. This is what they were expecting. For example, in the prophet Amos, in Amos chapter 9, verse 11, prophesied, "In that day I will raise up the booth of David that has fallen and repair its breaches and raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old." Now, at the time of the disciples' question, the kingdom of Israel was hidden under the suppression of the Roman government. There had been no restoration as of yet, and the people were starting to get a little anxious. They were yearning for the restoration of Israel, when national Israel would be free from Roman oppression and when the Messiah would reign as their king. This is what they were looking forward to. So when Jesus comes onto the scene, they start getting excited. Shortly after Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph, they bring him to Jerusalem to be presented in the temple. And there was a man there. His name was Simeon, who in Luke chapter 2, verse 25, says was waiting for the consolation of Israel. Like every other Jew, he was waiting for the restoration that was to come. But when Simeon sees Jesus, he prophesies that Jesus will be a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. All right. Then a prophetess by the name of Anna comes over to baby Jesus, same time. And Luke 2 verse 38 says that she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who are waiting for the redemption of Israel. All right. So these two individuals, they identify Jesus as this promised Messiah who would bring about this restoration. And so we see in Mark chapter 1 verse 15, when Jesus begins his earthly ministry, he begins by proclaiming that the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. I mean, if you're a Jew during this time, you're excited that things are actually getting ramped up for this restoration that your people have been longing for hundreds of years. And then we see that Jesus, he makes the blind to see and the lame to walk, right? He cleansed lepers. He opened the ears of the deaf. He raised the dead back to life. He preached good news to the poor. These were all activities of the Messiah that were prophesied about in the Old Testament. This is what the Messiah would do. Jesus is fulfilling all of these kinds of messianic prophecies. And really, he's showing himself to be this promised Messiah who is bringing the kingdom of God to earth. And it's after the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, as Jesus was speaking about the kingdom of God, the disciples, they're putting the pieces together And they say, Lord, at this time, will you restore the kingdom to Israel? We've seen all of these years of all these glimpses of this restoration. Are you going to do it fully and finally and forever now? They wanted so badly for that time to come. And in many ways, we can identify with the disciples, I think. You know, we look around at our world and we see a pandemic. We see war. We see injustice. We see political turmoil. I mean, today is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. You know, we take this day to celebrate God's gift of life and commit to protecting human life at every stage. Right? We are reminded on a day like today of the atrocities that take place on a daily basis. So surely, right? If Jesus were in our midst today, we would ask, Lord, will you at this time bring the kingdom of God to its completion? Because you see, as Christians, we find ourselves in the space between, the space between what Jesus inaugurated when he first came into this world and what Jesus will bring to completion when he comes again to fully and finally restore all things. I mean, that's what we were looking back. That's what we were doing in the month of December with Advent. Right? We're looking back at what Jesus first did, and we're looking forward to what Jesus will come again to fully and finally do. It's what theologians call the now, not yet kingdom of God. We see glimpses of the kingdom to come now in what Jesus has done, what Jesus continues to do. But then the consummation, the completion of the kingdom is still to come when Jesus returns, when Christ comes again. The Lord Jesus, he's currently ruling and reigning from his throne in heaven. But like the disciples, we long for the restoration to come. It's why the end of the book of Revelation contains the words, "Come, Lord Jesus." Because we are looking forward to the day when Jesus will come to make all things right. But the question of the disciples, it reveals how little they know about the kingdom of God. You see, the kingdom that the disciples were expecting was a restored national Israel, right? They were waiting for Israel to be restored to its glory and for the Romans to be wiped out and for this Messiah to reign over their nation. But the kingdom that Jesus was proclaiming went beyond Israel to a kingdom with no boundaries, a spiritual kingdom with implications for the world, right? We're not limited now to national Israel. This is global. The good news of Jesus Christ is that God's people are not restricted to national Israel, but includes all who repent and trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins. The kingdom of God is not found in a nation or in a political party or in a political leader. It's found in who we are in Christ. My identity is not rooted in being a Canadian. Right? I've said it before that I have more in common with an Iranian Christian than I do with a Canadian who doesn't believe in Jesus, simply on the basis of who we are together in Christ. That is what Jesus came to do. He didn't come to restore national Israel. He came to bring restoration to people from every tribe and tongue and nation that he might create in himself one new man. And thus, we see the kingdom of God expand beyond what even the disciples had thought or were expecting. But notice that Jesus doesn't rebuke his disciples for their question, right? He doesn't say to them, how many times do I have to tell you that I'm not going to restore the kingdom of Israel? No, Jesus says to them in verse 7, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father is fixed by his own authority. See, restoration will come. And Jesus will be the means by which restoration happens. That's not what Jesus is concerned about here. But he says, don't be worried about when it will come. It's coming. Don't be worried about when it will come. Instead, Jesus says to them in verse 8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria to the end of the earth. Right? Jesus tells his disciples that they are going to be empowered to speak boldly about what they've seen and heard concerning the person and work of Jesus Christ. This is going to be their mission. This is the mission of the church. We exist to bear witness to the rule and reign of Christ. Not to know times or seasons that the Father is fixed by his own authority. Several years ago, I was talking with someone who professed to be a follower of Jesus about our responsibility as Christians to do this, to proclaim the rule and reign of Christ. And they said to me that evangelism, telling others about Jesus, was not something they felt called to do as a Christian. And I said to them that if they were a follower of Jesus, then they ought to make it a point of telling others about Jesus, right? If we truly considered all that Luke wrote about in his gospel account, or even Mark, you know, because we went through Mark last year, right? Even consider Mark, all that Mark wrote about in his gospel account about the person and work of Jesus Christ, then there should be no hesitation on our part to tell others about Jesus, right? Because this Jesus, he's the real thing. He's the real deal. And if he is, then we need to make it a point of telling others about him. The vision statement of the Boyle Gospel Chapel is that we are committed to seeing believers actively involved in sharing the message of Christ. Right? If we are attending church services week after week and we don't leave here preaching, then we've missed the point of why we've gathered together in the first place. Right? If we think that it's someone else's responsibility to witness about Jesus, then we're wasting our lives. Worse than that, we are wasting the gospel of Jesus Christ. Being Jesus' witness in the world isn't just something that the pastor of the church does. It's not something that the spiritually elite do. It's something that every follower of Jesus does. And it doesn't mean that we need to go out preaching 40-minute sermons to our friends and family. But it does mean that all of us have a responsibility to take this message of repentance and forgiveness of sins to our families, to our friends, and our coworkers, and our neighbors. That there was not a square inch of our lives that ought to be untouched by the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not a square inch. And why is this so important that we are to be his witnesses is because we can look around and just see how the gospel has spread, right? I mean, I don't know how many people it really started off as, few hundred maybe followers of Jesus, and now, I mean, millions of followers of Jesus around the world. You can see the expanse of the gospel all over the place. Consider how you came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, right? My guess is that there was someone in your life, maybe a family member or a friend or a colleague or even a preacher, someone who introduced you to Jesus. And we have this amazing opportunity as followers of Jesus to be that someone to someone else. Right? Because someone was someone to you, and you have the opportunity to be someone to someone else. And listen, if you feel inadequate to be Jesus' witness, then that's probably a good thing. If we try to bear witness to Jesus in our own power, we'll fail. It's why Jesus says that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And when we become a follower of Jesus, we receive the Holy Spirit. This isn't something that happens later in life. It's something that happens immediately. And this power from the Holy Spirit it's not supposed to give us a spiritual high where we just feel good about ourselves and we go on our merry way. It sets us on mission to do what Jesus has commissioned us to do. That's what the power of the Holy Spirit is supposed to do in our lives. It's supposed to embolden us to go out and proclaim the gospel. Look at how many times the followers of Jesus in Acts refer to being Jesus' witness. All right, you see it in Acts 2, verse 32. Peter says, "This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses." In Acts chapter 3, verse 15, Peter says, "And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses." Acts 4, verse 33 says, "And with great power the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all." In Acts chapter 5, verse 32, Peter says, "And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given us to those who obey him." In Acts 10, verses 39 to 41, Peter says, "And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead." In Acts chapter 13, verses 30 to 31, Paul says, "But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people." In Acts 22, verse 15, Paul says, "For you will be a witness for him to everyone of what you have seen and heard." And then in Acts chapter 26, verse 16, Paul recalls the risen Lord Jesus saying to him, "But rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen me and to those in which I will appear to you." And so we see it. It's so clear. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses. It'll start in Jerusalem, and then it'll broaden to Judea and Samaria. It'll reach the Gentiles, and then, glory be to God, it's going to reach the ends of the earth. Luke records Jesus saying in Luke 9, verses 23 to 24, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it." Christ has not called us to a comfortable Christian life. It's not an easy thing to be Jesus' witness. It's why we need the Holy Spirit to give us boldness. But because Jesus is Lord of all, the gospel will go out to all. Because Jesus is Lord of all, the gospel will go out to all. One of the books I read when I was in school was Elizabeth Elliot's Through Gates of Splendor, which chronicles the slaughter of her husband and four other missionaries at the hands of the Aka Indians in Ecuador. Afterward, Elizabeth Elliot went back to Ecuador and continued to minister to the same Aka Indians who had killed her husband. She raised her daughter in the midst of that group. Some who converted through her ministry babysat her daughter. Another example. Here's a letter that the missionary Adoniram Judson wrote to his prospective father-in-law. He wanted to marry Anne, and he wanted to take her with him overseas to share the gospel with the heathen, as he called them. So he wrote this letter to his prospective father-in-law. Men, listen to what he says here, asking for permission to marry Anne. He says, I am now to ask whether you can consent to part with your daughter early next spring, to see her no more in this world. Whether you can consent to her departure and her subjection to the hardships and sufferings of missionary life. Whether you can consent to her exposure to the dangers of the ocean, to the fatal influence of the southern climate of India, to every kind of want and distress, to degradation, insult, persecution, and perhaps a violent death. Can you consent to all this for the sake of him who left his heavenly home and died for her and for you? For the sake of perishing immortal souls, for the sake of the glory of God? Can you consent to all this in the hope of soon meeting your daughter in the world of glory with a crown of righteousness brightened with the acclamations of praise, which shall resound to her Savior from heathens who have been saved through her means from eternal woe and despair? This is what it looks like to be a witness to Jesus. And listen, this doesn't mean that you need to move your family to Papua New Guinea in order to be a witness for Jesus, although that would be awesome. To the ends of the earth simply means taking the gospel to all people everywhere. The end goal of the church, you see, is not Canada. It's not Africa. The end goal of the church is the world. It doesn't matter where you are in the world. There are people there who need to hear about Jesus. And here's why this matters. After Jesus gives the Great Commission, verse 9 says that as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. Now note the contrast here. Jesus came to this earth in humiliation. I mean, we looked at that in December when we looked at the baby in the manger, right? But Jesus returns in glory, elevated to the right hand of God the Father. Right? It is this contrast that the Apostle Paul picks up on in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 11. Paul writes here, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore," all right, so there's the humiliation. "Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father." And there we see the exaltation. So we have this contrast here between Jesus' incarnation when he came in humiliation, humbled himself, taking the form of a servant, and then his ascension, where he is, where he's taken up into glory and he's exalted above every name. But then we also see this cloud of glory. And this isn't the first time that we've seen this cloud around Jesus. While Jesus and his disciples, Peter, James, and John, were on the Mount of Transfiguration, Luke 9, verses 34 to 35, says that a cloud came and overshadowed them. And they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." All right, so what we're seeing here in Acts is God the Father ushering God the Son to his rightful place as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is none other than the coronation of a king. This is the coronation of King Jesus. And listen, if Jesus is king, which what we're seeing here in this text is that he is, if Jesus is king, then that makes the commission of the king to us, the citizens of his kingdom, very important. Will we go against the king, the orders of the king? That's what is at stake here. You will notice that in verse 10, it says, "And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven.'" Well, what's happening here? The apostles are they're gazing into heaven. They're waiting for Jesus to return. They're waiting for that restoration to come. They don't know how long it's going to take. They just know it's coming eventually. But then these two men, these angels, they show up and they remind the apostles that they now have work to do. This isn't about sitting and waiting for Christ to return. They are to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father, which is the Holy Spirit. But then when that happens, they are to engage in mission to the ends of the earth. This is the commission of Jesus. Jesus will return. They don't need to wonder about when that will take place. It will. And when Jesus returns, that then we'll see the restoration that was promised. In 1 Thessalonians 4:16, the Apostle Paul writes, "For the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God." Jesus himself said to his disciples in Mark chapter 13, verse 26, that they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. We can be certain of the return of Christ. It could happen in our lifetime, but it might not. We don't know when Christ will return. In Mark 13, verse 32, Jesus said, "Concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father." We don't know when, but we can be certain that Jesus will come again. And we can know from what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 14, that the gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then, the end will come. So since the return of Jesus is assured, we are called to engage in mission to the world. The question is, are we engaging in mission, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom to the world, or are we idly waiting for Christ to return, expecting others to do what Jesus has called us to do? That's the question. Imagine that those of us gathered here online are the only followers of Jesus in the world. All right, I don't know how many people are watching this, but when I count the number of people in the church directory, we're looking at just over 60 people. So imagine that you are one of 60 followers of Jesus when Jesus gives this commission to you, to take the gospel from Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria and then to the ends of the earth. What do you do? What do you do? There are millions of people who are engrossed in false religions. Millions of people who have never heard the gospel. Millions of people on their way to an eternal hell. And we know, right, all 60 of us know that Jesus has come, that he died on a cross to save us from our sins, that he has risen from the dead, that he is coming again to renew and restore all things, and that we don't have to fear anything in this world because we know, right? We know that when we die, we will live forever with Jesus, saved from hell and saved from the condemnation of our sin. We have been charged to take this good news to the ends of the earth. That's why we're here. That's why we haven't been taken up immediately to be with Jesus. He's left us here for a reason, and that is to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. So the question is, do we stay comfortable in our group of 60 followers of Jesus strong, or do we go out and make disciples of all nations? What do we do? That's the question before us this morning. What will we do? Because we see that the gospel has gone out. The gospel has spread. Will we continue to be an instrument in that spread of the gospel? And you see, the thing is, we will talk about all kinds of things with other people. All right, we'll talk about the weather, we'll talk about politics, we'll talk about sports, we'll talk about family life. And certainly all of those things have their place, but will we talk with people about Jesus? All right, I know I'm bad for this. I love talking with people about sports and about movies and about my family. But there are times when I don't follow that up with talking about Jesus. It's easier, isn't it, to have surface conversations with people because then those areas in my life that I would rather keep hidden don't get exposed, right? But what we need is the transforming work of the gospel in our lives, which comes when we talk about Jesus. And so we need to be talking with people about what Jesus is doing in our lives. It's as simple as that. Regardless of how little our growth in Christ is, right? It's worth sharing with those around us because our family members and our friends and our coworkers and our neighbors and our world need to hear about what Jesus has done and about what Jesus continues to do in and through his witnesses. Because remember, these aren't just the acts of the apostles. They're not just the acts of me. They're the acts of the risen Lord Jesus. And the risen Lord Jesus continues to act today. Right? Each one of us who have put our faith in Jesus can point to times in our lives when we have seen him at work. And so the question is, will we tell others about it? Will we tell others about it? Jesus says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The question is, what will we do with the mission Jesus has given us to do? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. God, help us to be faithful witnesses. I pray this for my own life. We pray this for every single one of your followers here right now. Help us to proclaim the gospel with boldness. Help us to witness to you during these days, to people who are lost without you, who are on a road that leads to an eternal hell. Help us to witness to you during these days far more than we speak about anything else. God, help us to point people to you and to your word. Help us by the power of your Holy Spirit throughout the day to be thinking about who we can witness to and how we can be a witness to them. Give us your zeal, your heart to see the gospel spread to all nations. And God, make us a people ready for the return of your Son. In the name of the one who has filled us with the Holy Spirit to carry out your saving purposes, King Jesus, we pray. Amen. Benediction comes from 2 Corinthians 13, verse 14. And by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.